television, movies, the theater. Many times, musicals start in theaters and then move to movies. And often, there are changes. In fact, it's almost expected. Different songs, different orchestrations. Jerry Bach's Fiddler on the Roof, which is actually the first musical based on a Jewish subject, despite the fact that many Jewish people have been writing musicals and kind of couching their experience for years, including Leonard Bernstein, who in Candide, which is a cross between a musical and an opera, it's got a piece that was originally called The Old Lady's Jewish Tango. By the time it got to Broadway, it was just The Old Lady's Tango, but encapsulating certain aspects of the Eastern European Jewish experience. And we get that in Fiddler on the Roof, which is, by this point, Jerry Bach's music has been assisted in reorchestration and conducting matters. The overall musician for the enterprise is another up-and-coming composer, and it's John Williams, who we'll meet formally a little later.
A Fiddler on the Roof. Sounds crazy, no? But here, in our little village of Anatevka, you might say every one of us is a fiddler on the roof, trying to scratch out a pleasant, simple tune without breaking his neck. It isn't easy. You may ask, why do we stay up there if it's so dangerous? Well, we stay because Anatevka is our home. And how do we keep our balance? That I can tell you in one word. Tradition!
But let's face it, it's all about tradition and change, whether you're channeling birdsong that is live, pre-recorded birdsong in an updated messianic way, shall we say, in Einu Huani Rautavaara's Cantus Arcticus, a concerto for birds and orchestra, or another notorious bad boy of music, Karlheinz Stockhausen, associate of Pierre Boulez, reaching across the French and German divide after World War II to do all manner of avant-garde work, including a series of influential Klavierstücke, that's piano pieces, one of which, number 9, has the world's longest time signature. The opening motif, just two inverted power chords, a tritone apart. C, root position, do, so. First and only inversion, so, do. And then same thing with the F sharp chord. Also in first inversion, and it's Petrushka. Ad infinitum. Proto-minimalism. Minimalism is going to take off just next couple years. It's 1961, and stay tuned. And a later, arguably crazy house of mirrors, seven operas entitled Light, the subtitle 7 days of the week, not performed and not composed in the order of a traditional week, but encompassing 29 hours worth of amazing music, and that bests Wagner by a good deal, since A Complete Ring is about 15 hours or so. And amongst the bells and whistles, Wednesday includes the Helicopter String Quartet, in which the four members of a string quartet are transported up in four helicopters so they can buzz around with the music. West Virginia, taught many years at the University of Pennsylvania, one of the Philadelphia School of Composers. An American eclectic, influenced by Debussy, Mahler, Ives, Bartok, in many ways a modern mystic. I've had the privilege of knowing him since I was in junior high and played oboe in a youth orchestra organized by several conductors and composers in the Philadelphia suburbs, including the third of the Philadelphia School, Richard Wernick, George Crumb, James Freeman, and Richard Narmore. I remember sitting playing oboe adjacent to a man playing in the back of the viola section. He was helping out. And then I realized that he was on the back cover of a score that I had just acquired. And it's not this. It's not Macrocosmos Volume 1, oh no. It's not Echoes of Time in the River, but that was actually an early score. He won the Pulitzer Prize for this back in 1967. A wonderful piece, four processions, and the orchestra has to move around ritually. And there are all sorts of beautiful circular things that happen in later scores too. Here's one. And this gives you a little bit of that John Cagean improvisatory, aleatoric, indeterminate feel, and yet overall in a structure which is very coherent, very accessible in many ways. Many years later, I had the privilege of being on the northern coast of Oregon, of all places, Newport, Oregon, for a composer's festival. And finally, George and I had the chance to sit around for an interview. And then much later than that, encountered him again at a festival of new music in Sacramento, the American Music Festival. And there was a line stretched out the door after the concert of people waiting to get his autograph, buy music, and so on and so forth. A little sweet for Christmas, part of his spiritual aspect. Music for a summer evening. I remember getting frozen out of the premiere of this. Sorry, no room, at Swarthmore College back in 1975. I was just about to enter as an undergraduate student. That's all one can be there, Swarthmore College. Well, that looks like here. Oh, these are the big scores for which I've been searching. And this was my first encounter with Crumb, at least Crumb's music. And you can see that would have made somewhat of a stir. My oboe teacher at the time, Dorothy Freeman, was rehearsing the piece, scored for soprano, boy soprano, oboe, mandolin, harp, electric piano, and percussion. She was, of course, the oboist. And I was duly impressed. Such primitive, earthy notions as the, can we see it here? Dances of the Ancient Earth. Shawm-like oboe at this point. Very nice. And once more, a circular structure for the dance of the sacred life cycle, where the soprano on stage is in call and response with an unborn child off stage boy soprano. He's actually of age, of course. Quotations from a variety of sources. Bach, Mahler, different pieces. We'll hear in Night of the Four Moons in just a moment. The opening movement, which was written to commemorate the first landing on the moon, using, as is very typical of Crumb, texts by Federico Garcia Lorca. In this case, the moon is dead. La luna está muerto.
Muerta.
Oh, and Black Angels. We'll get to this in just a moment.
La luna está muerta, muerta. Thank you. muerta, muerta.
So sad.